Michael Frost is an internationally recognized Australian missionologist and one of the leading voices in the missional church movement. Frost is the vice principal of Moreland College and the founding director of the Tinsley Institute, a mission study center located at Moreland College in Sydney, Australia. He is also a senior lecturer with the Melbourne University of Divinity. Frost is the author or editor of a number of theological books, the most recent of which are the popular and award-winning The Shaping of Things to Come, Exiles, The Road to Missional, and Incarnate. These books explore a missional framework for the church in a postmodern era. Their popularity has led Frost to become a sought-after speaker at conferences in the United States, the United Kingdom, across Europe, and as far afield as Nairobi, Rio de Janeiro, and Moscow. Please welcome Michael Frost to the Restore Stage.
It feels like I'm a Grammy announcer or something like that. Like, welcome to the stage, presenting in the best actor category. Does it feel like that to you or no? Or maybe I just spoiled your worshipful moment, sorry. Hey, listen, I just feel like I only just got to know you and like this is the end, it's over. How about that? So this is our final session and my final chance to share with you. Thanks for all those of you who've had a chance to grab me in a corridor or say hello or sit with me at lunch or whatever the case may be. I appreciate it. And I'm sorry I didn't get to spend more time with you, actually. Let's wrap this up by reminding ourselves of some truths I think we already know, but we just need to be reminded of them quite regularly. And there's the timer thing isn't... I can talk all afternoon. Is that how that works? It's like... I get a free pass in the final session. So brace yourselves. This could take a long, long time. I think you probably already know this kind of stuff, but it is nice that we should gather at the end of your kind of conference. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper in a little while, and we're just going to remind ourselves of things that are like really key and important to us and propel ourselves out to continue to do the kind of work to which God has called us. So you'll remember, I hope, because it was only just a little while ago. In my previous session, I talked to you about a definition of mission that I actually have derived from a guy called David Bosch, who's a South African missiologist. The difficulty for lots of people when we talk about mission or being missional is that it's not a Bible word, right? So you can't actually go to the New Testament, find out where it talks about mission, because it doesn't use that term, because mission comes from a Latin term, not a Greek or a Hebrew term. And so we can only go on the Latin idea that mission comes from the term missio, which is a notion of being impelled or propelled, or kind of an outward thrust or an outward impulse. Some businesses and corporations talk about having a mission statement, and they really mean by that, they just mean a set of goals or objectives. But for us, we Bible people, when we talk about being missional or doing mission, we're really thinking about all the ways in which we have been propelled out beyond the faith community to represent King Jesus in the world of which we're part. And in lots of evangelical circles in particular, that often just gets reduced down to trying to recruit people to come to our church. But the idea of mission is actually much bigger and grander and more magnificent than that. So I'm going to repeat for you the definition that I've stolen from David Bosch. I did mention it to you in the first session, just to kick our thinking off about what it means for us to be missional, and in particular for you to be missional as Adventist leaders in this particular conference. So David Bosch said this. Mission, I actually have memorized it, that's how much I love it. Mission is more than and different to recruitment to our brand of religion. It is alerting everyone everywhere to the universal reign of God through Christ. That's pretty cool, don't you think? Mission is alerting everyone everywhere to the universal reign of God through Christ. And you can't simply reduce it to recruitment to our brand of religion away from some other brand that we're competing with. To be missional is to want to direct people to an understanding of what God's reign or what King Jesus' reign looks like. And so we should say right from the outset, you cannot be missional unless you have a profoundly devoted sense that our God reigns. And you can say that, but it often amazes me how lots of Christians don't seem to live lives that based on the assumption that King Jesus reigns. I am hearing people all the time, Christian people, complaining and worrying about where our world is going. Have you heard all this kind of talk? Like, oh no, the Muslims are taking over, or oh no, like the lesbians are taking over, or oh no, what will happen when this happens or that happens, and oh, it's evil and dark and terrible. And you think to yourself, wait a second, doesn't King Jesus reign? Isn't King Jesus king and ruler over all? Is there no usurper whatsoever to his reign? Does he not reign utterly, totally and completely? Well, what have we to worry about? Sure, at various places and at various times, sometimes the church is under enormous stress, sometimes persecution, sometimes it goes through a time of real winnowing. Sure, I'm not discounting that. It's not all upward journey all the time, getting better and better all the time. In different parts of the world, there are different experiences of that. But no matter what we face, we proceed forward on this fundamental assumption, our God reigns. Jesus is king. And there is no other pretender to the reign of God. It's not like Jesus reigns an awful lot. Like Jesus reigns like 80% his reign. Like if he tried a bit harder, he could reign maybe like 85%. You take by faith, based on the word of God, fundamental commitment to the belief that our God reigns through Christ utterly, totally, and completely, right? And indeed, this has been the mission of God's people throughout history, even in the Old Covenant. You'll be familiar in a number of occasions in the second half of the book of Isaiah. Now that you know what book I'm talking about, I'm just going to be referring to it as Isaiah, okay? In the second section of Isaiah, there is five occasions where the prophet says something similar to this. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news. That term, who bring good news, in Hebrew is basar. In the Greek translation, the Septuagint of the Old Testament, it's euangelizomai. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of the evangelists, to use a New Testament word in the Old Testament. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who declare, Isaiah then tells us what the gospel is according to Israel. Yahweh reigns. That's the gospel according to Israel. And when you think about that, there's something quite remarkable about it, really, isn't there? In which context was the book of Isaiah being written? Where was Israel at the time when they were receiving the prophecies of Isaiah? They were in Babylon, were they not? They were in exile. They were captives. Now think about this, like follow the logic of this. These people are slaves in a foreign pagan land. What happens on the mountains in foreign pagan lands? They have lookouts and beautiful views and parking lots and picnic grounds. The high places are where pagan people do what? Worship, and in particular, fertility worship, right? It's on the high places that there would be religious prostitution, the sacrifice to idols. In other words, on the mountains outside Babylon, these are the darkest places, in the darkest place that a Jew could ever imagine. Cut off from everything that they know to be truly and intrinsically theirs. They are slaves, they are captives to foreign pagan people. And Isaiah says, how beautiful on the high places in Babylon is the one who dares to announce, to evangelize, to proclaim, to say, Yahweh reigns. Now, could you imagine if a Babylonian got hold of the prophecies of Isaiah and read this? Could you imagine them like, what? Your God reigns? Hold on a second. Am I missing something? Aren't you my slave? Didn't we take you out of your land? You don't have land. You own nothing. You have no property, no land. You're a no people. You have no temple. You have no priests. Your king is under house arrest. You're a no people. And yet you're daring to stand on our high places and to declare that Yahweh reigns. In effect, for Isaiah to say how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news is like saying how beautiful are those of you who are foolhardy enough in the darkest place, in the darkest place on the planet Earth for a Jew at that time, to dare to stand up there and to declare that Yahweh reigns would be like whispering into a tsunami of paganism. And here's the thing for Israel. Even if all the evidence appears to be to the contrary, we still take by faith, come hell or high water, Yahweh is king. So therefore it should follow those of us for whom Yahweh's kingship has been revealed sublimely and utterly in the incarnation, the life, the teaching, the death, the resurrection of Jesus. How much more confidence could we have that come hell or high water, even if there are less Christians in America this year than there were last year, our God reigns through Christ. Even if there are less Christians on the face of the earth this year than there were last year, our God reigns through Christ. Even if you're down to your last Adventist congregation and someone's planning to turn the lights out, you can still say, our God reigns through Christ. It's what our brothers and sisters in North Korea say. It's what our brothers and sisters in Somalia say. It's what our brothers and sisters in Sudan say. It's what our brothers and sisters in China say. It's what our brothers and sisters in Egypt say. Even if I'm the last one left, even if there is none of us left, our God reigns. Because we don't believe that based on evidence, we take that by faith. You can't be missional without a resolute and absolute unshakable confidence in the reign of God, since the very act of mission is to alert people to the reign of God. How could you do that if you have a shaky confidence in that reign? Does this make sense? Yeah? Our God reigns is the very essence of what missional people are committed to. Now, people would hear me, I talk this way to my students, and my students say to me, well, yeah, okay, I take it by faith, I believe he reigns utterly, totally, and completely, but it doesn't look like it sometimes. Absolutely. Tom Wright put it this way. He said, while we take by faith that the reign of God is total, utter, and complete, in our present reality, we perceive of it fitfully, partially, and mysteriously. Fitfully meaning it bursts forth and then seems to recede. Has that been your experience? Times when you sense the presence of God really keenly and then disappears again. Time when there's great fruit and blessing, and other times when you can't. It seems to burst forth fitfully. It's partial because not everyone gets healed. Not everyone gets saved. Not every unjust structure is unraveled. Not every need is met. It's partial. And it's mysterious because you often find yourself asking, well, they both said the same kinds of prayers, but you healed him and not her. You blessed this church and not that way. There's a mystery to this. Our perception of the reign of God is fitful, partial, and mysterious, but that doesn't shake our faith in the fact that it's total, utter, and complete. You all with me? In the previous session, I talked. I used the illustration of it being like we're like trailers in a movie theater, right? So a little taste of what the full reign of God looks like. Let me give you an illustration. One that kind of makes sense of this two tiers that we operate at, the utter, total, and complete, and the fitful, partial, and mysterious. One of my students suggested this to me, and I'm not going to give you his name because I'd like to take credit for it myself. He said, just try and imagine that you are in a derelict or an abandoned house. It's just a terrible, ugly old house. And you've got to stretch your imagination a bit because it's a bit of an obtuse kind of illustration, but it works really beautifully. Just imagine that you're locked in a room in this house. And I want you to imagine you're locked in a room in this house with another person. I want you to imagine that this room is like the walls are covered with graffiti. And over the top of that is like several layers of dust and soot and grime. Just try to imagine that a mattress has been burned out in this room. The windows are caked with filth and black and soot. It's effectively just a totally blackened and dark room. There's just one window, as I said, covered in soot and grime. You can't even see out of it. I want you in this illustration to imagine being in that room with someone while right outside the window, right now, the most stunning sunrise is bursting over the horizon. I want you to imagine that there are low clouds hanging on the horizon, and as light bursts over the horizon, it refracts throughout the clouds. The dark black sky is turning deep blue, light blue, red and orange. It's absolutely breathtaking. Shafts of light are bursting over the horizon as the land turns golden and the field between here and there is verdant green. It's just the most stunningly gorgeous sunrise you've ever seen. You with me? Imagine that you're in a room with this person who's never seen a sunrise before. This is where the illustration gets a little bit creepy, but just go with me. You're in a room with someone who's never ever seen a sunrise before, but they can feel just the glow that coming through this blackened window. What would you do to alert the person what that glow is every day around this time? Well, you could describe it, couldn't you? You could say, hey, have you ever wondered why that window kind of glows? Like the darkness just becomes slightly opaque? Have you ever wondered what that's for? Yeah, they'd say, actually, what is all that? And then you would say, well, on the other side, like just outside that window, this incredible sunrise. And then you'd describe it. You'd talk about it, right? Well, I would. And look, I don't know. I think my powers of description are kind of good, don't you? Did you like my description before? Like refracting light and, you know, the verdant, you know, green shafts of, you know, not that impressed, obviously, but I was just bringing all the descriptive language I could possibly bring to try and explain to this person what's going on out there. But eventually, sooner or later, it'd be like, the words just aren't good enough. Like, I mean, it's just more beautiful than these words could possibly say. What would I need to do to kind of really let this person know what that sunrise looks like? You'd need to clean the windows. Right, you need to, every time I use this illustration in America, somebody says, break the window. We're going to get to breaking the window in a little while. No, you would clean the window. And of course, it's thick with years of grime. You don't just like wipe it and it's clean. Basically, you're just moving this, smearing the dirt around, aren't you? Maybe like with your elbow, you could kind of create a hole where light would burst through. Basically, you are just making this darkened and opaque window less and less opaque so that the person in the room with you could see more and more of that magnificent sunrise. To me, this is a beautiful illustration of the mission of God's people. You are in a world with people who do not recognize or know what the reign of God looks like. They have no clue. They've been told a million times that they're sinners and that if they say a special prayer to Jesus, they'll go to heaven when they die. But they have no clue what the universal, utter, total, complete, and sublime reign of God looks like. This is the mission of God's people, to describe it, to speak about it, to explain it. But there comes a point at which all the words kind of run out, and then in the end it's like, here, can I show it to you? It's about justice. It's about peace, about reconciliation, it's about beauty, it's about wholeness. Do you follow? Some question I had before this morning, like the disconnection between evangelism and justice, there should be none. These things are two and the same. I explain it, and I show it. Now, back to the guy who wants to smash the window. I actually think a day is coming when Jesus returns, he doesn't smash the window. What does he do? He like blows the whole window right out of its frame. Boom! And now, what we could only just kind of see like this, we see utterly, totally, and completely. But here's the deal. That's not your job. That's the work of Christ. Until he chooses to do that, your job is you are a spiritual window cleaner. You describe the sunrise, and you show people the sunrise, and you equip people in your church to describe the sunrise and to show people the sunrise. So let me ask you this question, and it's not an unfair one. If I was to take an inventory of your life, if I was to do an examination of the life of your church, what would I discover about the reign of God from observing your life or your church's life? Because whatever the answer to that question is, that's the mission you're committed to. So if all I would see is going to church on Sabbath, if all I would see is like following certain traditions and rituals, if all I would see is that you're vegetarian and teetotal, if that's all I would see, but otherwise, in every other aspect of your life, you spend your money the same way that pagans do, you have the same values that pagans do, you take the same vacations that pagans do, you spend the same money on your kitchen renovation as pagans do, you put your kids in the same schools as pagans do. If your life just looks like all the other fine, upstanding, middle-class people, that's your mission. It's reduced to institutional religiosity. Ask yourself, what are the characteristics of the reign of God? Talk about that and demonstrate that. Show people that. Clean the windows. I believe our God reigns. I have absolute confidence in it. I think our God is present in the brothel and in the pub and in Disneyland as well as in the Adventist church. Someone once said to me, has God left the mega church? Left the mega church? I said, I think he's in the brothel. Of course he's in the mega church. Where is he not? Where are his values not unfurling? Where is the sunrise not occurring? Jesus himself said, he didn't say the sunrise, he said the rain falls on the just and the unjust alike, right? God's reign is unfurling. Here's your job. Talk about it. Whisper about it. Witness to it. Talk about how it's affected your life. Demonstrate it. Show people. Point people. Alert people to the fact that our God reigns. And I promise you, you'll end up doing some of the coolest and most awesome non-religious things through which you will show people what real justice looks like, not left-wing liberal justice. Where you show people what real reconciliation looks like, not the kind of racial disjunctions you have in this country. Where you show people what real beauty looks like. Just Google images beauty. You know what comes up? Gorgeous, scantily clad women. But we know what redeemed beauty looks like, don't we? We know what beautiful music and beautiful food and beautiful juice looks like. We know what real beauty looks like. I mean, we have been the beautiful ones. We should recover this. And you guys have got the jump on showing what real wholeness looks like. What the reign of God looks like is people get healed. People are made whole. People become healthy. You could do that through hospitals, you could do that through medical centers, you can do that through nursing and therapy and counseling, but you could also just lay hands on people and like see them get healed, huh? Drive a few demons out here and there, right? Like this is what the rain, this is the sunrise. You just simply ask yourself, when Jesus returns and blows the window right out of the frame and we see utterly, totally and completely, what would that be like? And then go and do that. You can't do it fully. That's his work. You can create foretastes and signs to that. Do you follow? And if you think in the age to come it's just an eternal Sabbath school service thing, do it. I'm hoping there's more to it myself, but if you think it's about justice and mercy and peace and wholeness, show them. Speak about it. There is no true justice but through the work of Christ. There's no real reconciliation but through the work of Christ. Real beauty is only possible through the redemption of Jesus. We're only made actually whole through Christ. Clean some windows. If I did an inventory of your life, what would I learn about the reign of God? And if you need to repent and change, put some things down and take some things up, do it. We're not here long, right? You didn't end up in ministry just to run an institutional religion. I don't even know you, but I know that about you. You followed a call to ministry because you wanted to alert people to the reign of God. Let some things go. Pick some things up. Orient your life to the kinds of things that both demonstrate and announce the reign of God. Don't waste your time. Don't be afraid. Be free. Our God reigns. What's the worst could happen? The window will be blown out one day. So practice now what eternity will be like. Can I close by telling you a story about my favorite missionary? I hope it'll be instructive to you. I occasionally go to Cambodia, which is just north of Australia, not far from us. So maybe it's a little bit like South America is for you guys. I go to Cambodia and I teach Khmer pastors. The Khmer people are the people of Cambodia. Most Khmer pastors are like in their 50s. Not that there's anything wrong with that, by the way. They wear like white business shirts buttoned at the wrists, like pleated pants and shiny black shoes. They have kind of rimless glasses and they part their hair on one side. They look like accountants. They look like this dude over here. He looks like he's not quite old enough yet, but you're on the way. And they just look like, oh, they know what they're doing. I only tell you that because on this particular occasion, I was teaching a room full of Khmer pastors. And in the back row, sitting on a chair, leaning back on the back two legs with his back against the wall, there's a dude sitting in the back. He's got a black leather jacket. He's got reflective wraparound sunglasses on. He's got a goatee. He's got boots and jeans on. He's got his arms folded and he's leaning on this chair just like listening to me, nodding every so often. All the Khmer pastors are writing down everything that I say. So I figure, well, he's obviously not a pastor. I wonder who he is and why he's in this meeting. This particular facility we were using was a room above a bakery right in the middle of Phnom Penh. Now, if you've ever been to Phnom Penh, you'll know it's like 100 degrees and 100% humidity every day, right? So when you're on top of a bakery, can you imagine? Like I had perspiration, like pouring off me. None of the Khmer pastors do. They look as fresh as a daisy, but I am drenched. While I'm teaching, I see that the doors here all open out onto this big patio, which then looks out over the Tonle Sap River. That's the brown river that flows through the middle of Phnom Penh. So while I'm teaching, God doing the translation, I'm fantasizing that if I go out there, there will be a beautiful cool breeze just wafting off the Tonle Sap River. Now, you know how God created the world and he built into this world all these kind of irrefutable laws like the law of aerodynamics and the law of gravity, thermodynamics, laws, immutable laws that keep the world in harmony. Well, one of the laws that he built into the universe was this. There will never be a cool breeze in Phnom Penh ever. So when I give them a break so that they may go and drink hot beverages and eat freshly baked goods, I stumble out here onto this patio in the vain hope it will be cooler, but it's not. I'm standing looking out over the river when the dude comes and stands next to me. He introduces himself. He says, "Hi, I'm Abraham Hang." I said, "Abraham, that's a Bible name." "Yeah," he said, "that's the name I got when I got converted." Oh, I said, "So you're a Christian?" "Yeah." I said, "Are you a pastor?" He said, "Yeah, why does everyone ask me that question with that tone of voice?" was like, I'll tell you why, because you're a dude and they all look like accountants. Like, you don't look like a typical pastor. Like, what's your story? No, he says, not that interesting, really. And then he told me a story that was incredibly interesting. Abraham Hang was a black marketeer. He used to have a little network of bad dudes that used to like steal stuff in Thailand and smuggle it over the Thai-Cambodian border and sell it at a premium to the Khmer. He was a bad cat, by all accounts. One day, the cops come for him. He takes it on the lam. He climbs out a window. He ends up hiding out in some small little village right in the middle of Cambodia just until the heat dies down. And while he's there, worst thing that could ever have happened to a bad, bad criminal, a pastor with a white shirt buttoned at the wrist and hair parted on one side talks to him about King Jesus, and he gets radically converted. He gives his life to Christ. He starts going to this little church in the middle of nowhere. He says to me, Mike, you know, he said, when you go to the Wat, when us Buddhists go to the Wat, like, you don't have to be quiet. Like, we smoke, we talk, we do business transactions. Like, I didn't know you weren't meant to do that in church. So they take me to church. I'm talking. Hey, everyone, how you doing? Hey, listen, do you need a television? I've got a few. He's like, and then in the end, while they're doing stuff, I'm like, hold on, excuse me, what does that mean? Why are we singing those words? Is that in the Bible? Where did you find it in the Bible? What does this mean? Why did he say that? Who said that? I just got like a million questions. And the poor pastor was like, I can't cope with all of your questions. It's too many. You know what I think you should do? I think you should go to Phnom Penh Bible School. So here's an adult convert that the church can't cope with, so they send them to Bible college. That happens in my country too. He goes to Phnom Penh Bible School. He does a 3-year diploma in ministry. He doesn't feel called to ministry. He doesn't even know what he's doing. He's just there trying to get some backfill so he now knows what he believes as a Christian. He meets a young woman there. They fall in love. They get married. He graduates. And then he goes out to every church, every denomination, every organization, every mission agency, every Christian anything, knocks on the door. Here's my diploma of ministry. Could you use me as like a pastor, a worker? With his reflective wraparound sunglasses and his black leather jacket. And every single one of them are like, thanks, yeah, no. We're standing on this patio looking over the river. And he says, Mike, I was standing right there by the river. And I cried out to God. I said, God, what do you want from me? I am trapped. I can't go back to my life of crime. I there's no opportunity for me to go forward. What do you want? I mean, all I know how to do is to be a criminal or a pastor. I said, you, in America, you can combine those things. I mean, he said, I was standing on the side of the Tonle Sap River and I cried out, what do you want from me? He said, and then God answered that question in the most terrible, terrible way. On the other side of the river, the steep bank of the river, as far as the eye could see, was littered with houses in a squatter village. Anyone been to Southeast Asia? You know when the rivers, they flood in the wet season? So these houses, they're just basically corrugated iron boxes on big bamboo stilts, perched on the sides of these riverbanks. That's public land. They're squatting there. And as Abraham cried out, God, what do you want from me? A convoy of military trucks pulled up on the other side of the river. And a commander with a loudspeaker yelled out, you are being repatriated from this land. Bulldozers are coming in a minute and they are going to literally level every house along this river. Grab your belongings, your chickens, your things, your children. Get in the back of these trucks. It's like Stalin's Russia. Hundreds of families are loaded into the backs of these trucks. Women are screaming for their children. People are crying out. Parents can't find kids. It's chaos. Abraham says, I just stood here and watched this all unfold. And then the truck started up and this convoy snaked its way out through the city streets. And he said to me, Mike, I don't know if you believe this stuff, but I swear to you, I heard an audible voice say to me, there is your church. So what did you do? He said, I got on the back of my motor. I got on my moto and I followed them. I followed them out through the teeming streets of Phnom Penh. I followed them out onto the freeway out to the airport. They went beyond the airport. They turned right onto a dirt road through rice paddies. They rumbled wide out into the middle of nowhere, out into swampland, mosquito-infested swampland. They turned left on a muddy, muddy road. They rumbled their way out into mosquito-infested swamp, and there they disgorged hundreds of families into the mud. They threw piles of corrugated iron, bamboo poles, and they said, you can live here. I said, what did you do? What do you think? I got on my moto. Now that I knew where they were, I rode all the way home. My wife had been praying all day. I burst in the door. I said, honey, I got a job. Abraham Hang was 26 years old when he moved his pregnant wife into what's called Andong Resettlement Village. They got corrugated iron and bamboo. They built a shack and they moved into one of the poorest communities in one of the poorest countries in the world. I said, where do you begin? Well, he said, look, I just had this view from what I picked up on Bible college. You know, here's what mission is. It's alerting people to the reign of God. So I just thought to myself, what will life be like when Christ returns? And I thought to myself, well, when Jesus returns and everything is made new, we will live on dry land. Do you believe that, Mike? He says to me. And I was like, I didn't even thought of that question before, but now that you come to mention it, yeah. He's like, right. He said, like, it's wrong. You should live in mud up to your ankles in the dry season, up to your knees in the wet season, mosquitoes. Nah, he said, that's not the reign of God. So I called all my mates. They're all graduates from Bible College. They're pastors around the city. I said, get as many men as you can, all the tools that you can. They joined forces with all the men in Andong. We dug these huge channels all the way through the village that was being built. Now when it rains, the water drains away. Andong is on dry land surrounded by swamp because dry land is an expression of the reign of God. And then he said, oh, these kids, they were sick all the time. Their teeth were falling out. Every sickness or disease that swept through there. He said, I thought to myself, that's in the age to come. There'll be no sickness or disease, right? Now, I had actually thought about that one before. So I was like, yeah, right, no sickness or disease. Right, so you know what I did? I just like called all my friends from Bible College. I got asked them, are there any doctors or dentists in your church? I got the name of every single doctor and dentist, Christian doctor and dentist in Phnom Penh. I called all the NGOs, I called all the Christian mission. I just got a list of all these Christian doctors and dentists. Then I would just ring them and make an appointment. I'd go and sit in the waiting room. They'd call me in for a consult. I'd sit down, they'd say, how can I help you? And he'd say, look, I'm fine, teeth are good, I feel good. It's just that I have a message from God for you. And then so I used to pull out my diploma in ministry and I'd say, this qualifies me to tell you what I'm about to say. He said, there is a verse in the Bible somewhere that says, there is a special place in hell reserved for any doctor or dentist that doesn't come to Andong to help us. He said, they would all laugh like you just did. And then they'd be like, how am I meant to do that? It's no trouble. He said, I'm setting up a mobile clinic. Would you at least commit to like a day a month? So that every day there's a doctor or a dentist in Andong bringing medicine and healing to that community. And then he said, like, we're all living under corrugated iron. When you live under corrugated iron in a swamp outside Phnom Penh, it's like living in a microwave oven. I met this woman. She was a missionary from Seattle. She said that she came from a mega church. I didn't know what that was, but I just thought mega sounded pretty cool. So I said, mega, like as in big? Yes, she said, as in lots of money, he said. Yes, she said, right. He said, can I get some? That one church in Seattle has paid for the materials for Abraham and the community to build hundreds of thatched roof houses with windows and doors. It's still not luxury, but it's way better than living under corrugated iron. Then he bought a truck so he could ferry men into the city every day so that they could find odd jobs and menial laboring jobs. And then he started a preschool. And then, of course, he'd been talking about Jesus all this time. So now all these people are putting their trust in Jesus and a church starts. And he's telling me about all this kind of stuff. And then he said to me, so hard to explain. Would you like to see it? And I said, I'd like to see it more than anything. I've been in slums all over Southeast Asia, but I want to see this one. When I'd finished teaching those pastors, I got on the back of his moto. We wound through the streets of Phnom Penh, out past the airport, through those rice paddies on that muddy track, out to Andong. And there it appears in the midst of swamp, on dry land, thatch roof houses, happy kids, a dental and medical clinic, church, life. It's heaven. It's the reign of God bursting forth. I don't know you people very well, but I'm pretty sure you don't want to live there. I don't really want to live there either. But for these people, it is heaven on earth. I walked through the streets of Andong. People would come out. I'd see all the channels. Show me the school, the church. People would come out and they would start, as the Khmer do, they would greet me. And they start speaking to me in Khmer, and I'd be like, Abraham, what is this lady saying to me? Oh, he said, don't bother him, don't bother. No, I said, what is she saying? Well, she's just telling you that she used to gamble all her family's money away. She was addicted to gambling. And when I told her about Jesus, she was set free, and now her family is prospering for the first time. I was like, well, that's pretty good. Next guy wants to tell me how he used to beat his wife. He was violent when he got drunk. Jesus set him free. These people are coming out and declaring to me the reign of God. We go to a coffee shop in Andong. It's still bamboo floor, corrugated iron roof. It's really, really hot. The coffee is really, really bad. So I said to him, there's still kingdom work to be done in this place, brother. Like, and as we were chatting about all this stuff that he's doing, the reign of God bursting forth in the midst of living hell, I said, this is a beautiful missional project. Which thought leaders have really shaped your thinking? Now, his English is pretty good, and my Khmer is non-existent, but he didn't quite get that. I said, hold on, wait. Which books did you read that gave you a vision to do what you're doing? I don't know what I thought he was going to say. David Bosch, Leslie Newbegin. Oh man, I couldn't have done it without Alan Hirsch. All that kind of missional church stuff. He couldn't read any of that stuff, folks. You know why? Because publishers don't really care to translate it into a language where people can't afford to buy it. When I asked him, what books did he read that shaped his vision to do what he's doing, he said, I gotcha. Okay, the Acts of the Apostles, James, well, Luke too, Luke Acts. He was 26 years old. He read Luke and Acts. He moved into a slum, and he did it. It's pretty much worth asking, what the heck are you doing? With all your capacity, all your autonomy, all your extraordinary freedom, all your opportunity. Someone once said to me when I told that story, but it's easier in Cambodia, know what the issues are. Yeah, it is easier to know what the issues are. But the issues here just happen to be different, not any less, right? There is still domestic violence and loneliness. There is still drug addiction. There is still dislocation. There is still the need for reconciliation. No, the needs are different, but they're no easier. After he dried out that land, a local governor called him in and said, this land is now worth something. Thanks for drying it out. We're going to evict them, push them further out. And I'm going to sell this land. And Abraham said this to him, "We can see your trucks coming from a long, long way away because it is flat. And when we see them coming, I swear to you as a man of God, I will meet you in the middle of the one road into Andong, and you will need to run me down. You will need to kill me to take my people." Can you say that about your town? They don't want the scandal of killing a pastor to destroy a slum, so they've backed off. But my friends, if a kid like Abraham Hang can read Luke and Acts and commit himself even to the last breath in his body to see the reign of God unfurl in the midst of broken people and to alert others to the rule of King Jesus, don't tell me you can't do more than you're doing. Don't tell me you don't need to let go of some things and take some other things up. The mission of God's people is to alert everyone everywhere to the universal reign of King Jesus, perceived here fitfully, partially and mysteriously, but held by faith by a group of people who know it's total, utter, and complete. All hail King Jesus. All hail King Jesus. You are good and merciful. You are kind and beautiful. We yearn for the day when you overcome all injustice and brokenness and poverty, all fear and loneliness and violence. We yearn for it, King Jesus. Come. Come and usher your kingdom in so that we might see it utterly, totally and completely. But until that day, we offer ourselves afresh to alert everyone everywhere to the beauty and the justice, the kindness and the reconciliation of your magnificent and wonderful reign. Amen.